Welcome everyone to Voice for Girls 2021, our 10th annual forum to rally business and community leaders around girls and their leadership potential. This is now our second virtual Voice for Girls. Of course, we'd rather be with you in person and are feeling pretty optimistic that that will be the case next year. Fingers crossed. My name is Sabine Lerner, and I'm a Gold Award Girl Scout, Girl Advisor to the Board of Directors of Girl Scouts of Orange County, and high school senior at Tustin High School. Thank you for joining us today. By adding your voice to today's conversation, you are supporting thousands of young women like me, who will one day enter the workforce and achieve our dreams. I've been a Girl Scout since I was a daisy in kindergarten. That's 13 years of leadership training. Throughout my childhood, Girl Scouts has provided me with a safe and welcoming environment to meet people, make friends, try new things, and develop lifelong skills. As I head off to college in the fall, I am proud to carry forward the confidence, character, and resilience I have built in Girl Scouts. I know that I speak for nearly 18,000 Girl Scouts across Orange County when I share with you that I look forward to a future where women's diverse voices are embraced, welcomed, and valued. Thank you for joining us today to build that future. Now, we would like to extend our thanks to our 2021 Voice for Girls sponsors who made today's event possible, including our presenting sponsor, Angels Baseball, our gold sponsors, silver sponsors, and in-kind sponsor. Thanks to the generosity of our sponsors, Girl Scouts is proud to offer Voice for Girls 2021 at no cost for all who wish to attend, helping us to expand the reach of this year's vital conversation. Now it is my pleasure to introduce Molly Jolly, Chair of the Board of Directors of Girl Scouts of Orange County and Senior Vice President of Finance and Administration for Angels Baseball.
Thank you, Sabine. As Chair of the Board of Directors of the Girl Scouts of Orange County, a lifetime Girl Scout member, and a recipient of the Girl Scout Gold Award, I know firsthand the power of Girl Scouting in preparing girls for a lifetime of leadership. I could not be more proud of Sabine and all of the graduating Girl Scouts. The challenging year that they have faced and at a pivotal time in their life and the resiliency with which they have demonstrated is nothing short of remarkable. I cannot wait to see what they will accomplish next. Hi, I'm Molly Jolly, Senior Vice President for Angels Baseball. Angels Baseball is proud to be the presenting sponsor for Voice for Girls 2021. Like the Girl Scouts of Orange County, we have been serving communities in our county for 60 years. And in fact, this year we are celebrating the 60th anniversary of our franchise. Angels Baseball and its foundation through the game of baseball has been serving and providing impact to many youth in our community for years. As a female in an industry considered to be male dominated and someone who grew up as a Girl Scout, I can attest to the vital knowledge that the program of Girl Scouting through its four pillars provides to girls. That's STEM, outdoors, entrepreneurship, and life skills. I know I benefited from the Girl Scout program in learning things such as team building, problem solving, and self-confidence, and it has helped me on my career journey. I look forward to seeing what today's Girl Scouts accomplish and enter the ranks, the executive ranks of the sports industry, as well as so many other sports, demonstrating the tools to excel, break barriers, and become tomorrow's leaders. As we kick off the Voice for Girls 2021, I could not be more proud to be part of an organization that provides meaningful impact to girls and sets them up to change the world. It is now my pleasure to welcome Girl Scouts of Orange County CEO Vicki Shepp, who will introduce today's important conversation.
Thank you, Molly and Angels Baseball, for your incredible support as our presenting sponsor of Voice for Girls 2021. We also extend our deepest thanks to all our sponsors listed on the screen who are paving the way for women through your investment in girls who will change the world. We applaud you. For over 100 years, Girl Scouts has prepared girls to be the leaders and change makers our nation needs. And I think we can all agree that never has that been more important. When selecting our topic for Voice for Girls each year, we look for an issue we can address together to prepare girls for a lifetime of leadership, no matter what path they choose. Without a doubt, we are living through a time like no other. After enduring more than a year of virtual meetings, mask wearing, physical distancing, and pods, finding our place so we can move forward and thrive will be essential. Who will be part of our new pod, our safe space to grow, to share successes and challenges? In a world of boys' clubs, Girl Scouts give girls their own club, her own pod, where she can build the confidence and resilience that come with taking risks and learning to innovate and problem solve. The power of the all-female environment in fueling female leaders is real, and that's what we're here to talk about today. You'll hear this morning from our keynote, Dr. Andrea Bastiani Archibald, or Dr. A, as many of us call her, about how the all-girls space provides an oasis in girls' lives. While girls and boys spend the majority of their time together, when there are no boys to be compared to or to compare herself to, she can discover her passions, stretch her limits, and shine her absolute brightest. And you'll hear from our esteemed panelists about the power and impact of female affinity groups within their organizations and how they also provide that same safe space. And of course, you'll hear from amazing Girl Scouts about action they are taking today to change the world. As we talk this morning about maximizing the power of all girls spaces and female affinity groups, it is vital as business and community leaders that we recognize the importance for organizations today to have a clearly articulated business case for women, active male engagement in championing women, and the commitment of real resources. Our goal for you this morning is to leave Voice for Girls with new information and tools to champion diverse workplaces that fuel female ambition, to leave inspired and empowered to affect positive change in your professional and personal spheres of influence. On behalf of all girls, all women, now, please join me in welcoming our keynote speaker, Dr. Andrea Bastiani Archibald. Dr. A is a renowned developmental psychologist and authority on child development, leadership, diversity, and inclusion. The intersection of social, emotional, and physical health and cultural influences on youth. She serves as both a psychologist and strategic advisor to several educational technology startups. Previously, Dr. A was a longtime executive at Girl Scouts of the USA, where she led the renowned Girl Scout Research Institute and used its insights to advance the interests and needs of girls, drive the organization's national lead strategy and development of new partnerships, and integrate relevant mission-based digital solutions. We are so very honored to have Dr. A with us today. Welcome to Voice for Girls 2021.
Thank you so much for that incredibly warm welcome, Vicki. And thank you to everyone who is joining us here today. I am so delighted to finally be here. I was supposed to be here last year in person, then this year in person, but if this is our opportunity, I'm ready for it. Before we get started fully, I want to thank all the distinguished business and community leaders who are here today. We want to especially recognize elected officials and their representatives, including Orange County Supervisor Katrina Foley, Mayor Peggy Huan, Vice Mayor Tammy Kim, Council Member Anthony Kim, Congresswoman Michelle Steele, Orange County Supervisor Andrew Doe, State Senator David Min, Assembly Member Lori Davis, Assembly Member Kadi Patri Norris, and Superintendent of Schools, Alma Harris. Thank you so much for having me. Let's get started on our great topic today. So consider these words and images. We can do it. Girls can do anything boys can do. You go, girl. Girl power. And Beyonce's anthem, Run the World, Girls. Messages of girl power continue to be everywhere. But are women really feeling it today? I used to talk about how words alone won't solve gender issues in schools, communities, workplaces, or leadership, but they were simply lip service. And now, despite the fact that we have our first female vice president who is truly someone to celebrate, the challenges to girl power are feeling more heavier than ever. Thank you for the next slide. So women's leadership drives important economic and societal benefits, there's no doubt. And at the time that I initially penned this keynote, women were achieving a greater number of leadership roles than ever before. They were still lagging behind men, but they were doing better. However, with the addition of the pandemic, we're sliding backwards. Next slide, please. So what are the costs to women? What are the costs to society? And how can all female spaces, physical and alternative virtual networks, and female relationships change this trajectory for women and for society? As mentioned, going into the pandemic and in early 2020, women were making great progress, but there were still ways to go. Now, though, the majority of those previously working who have dropped out of the workforce, either voluntarily or not, they're women. Nearly 3 million American women have left the labor force over the past year due to, I love this term, I've heard it from another speaker I was listening to, a pandemic-induced exodus that reflects persistent pay inequity, undervalued work, and outdated notions of caregiving and household responsibilities. These things have led to more than 50% of women indicating they're constantly exhausted and they have real concerns about their day jobs, those they're being paid for. Those continuing to look for work are also exhausted, but feeling increased levels of imposter syndrome. Who were they before all of this happened to us? And can we ever be that again? This is holding them back. So before the pandemic, women consisted of 50% of the US workforce, underlining their importance to the economy and innovation. But that number has dropped sharply, and women, particularly mothers of young children, have been furloughed or laid off. And women who are frontline workers, because the majority of frontline workers are women, they've had to choose between taking care of their young children or going to work. Because so many schools and daycare centers have been closed. So while women's participation in the workforce continues to decline, and this is data as recent as January of this year, men's participation remains flat. So I have concerns about what this means for women and for society, but also for innovation when we have diverse groups around the leadership table creating the solutions of today and tomorrow. But alas, that's actually a different talk, so I'll save that for another day. Clearly, girl power isn't all it's cracked up to be. It's certainly not adequately supported. Next slide. So we need spaces where women are wholly seen, heard, and valued, where they're supported, where experiences are created for how they uniquely learn and lead, not just based in a shared gender. Where they are told they are capable of anything, where they can hear from and share with those who have been there, even during these challenging times. Where they can see themselves filling every role. All female spaces are more important than ever today. Next slide. As I'm speaking on behalf of Girl Scouts of Orange County, I'd be remiss if I didn't share some of the valuable underpinnings of our Girl Scout leadership experience, which of course is an all-female space. Not surprisingly, those most effective all-female spaces for adult women share many of the same attributes. They're inclusive and collaborative, when too often girls are in settings that are overly competitive and exclusionary. At Girl Scouts, we have high expectations for girls' relationships. We show girls that girls and women have their backs. Our girl-only space offers girls the exposure and real opportunities, the time and the practice to try their hands at things they may not have thought were for them or that they'd be interested in or good at. We are all about building a real sense of confidence and empowerment, and the way we create these spaces and experiences does that. You'll see similar characteristics here that benefit girls and women's engagement, in all female networks, even when they've attained those coveted leadership roles. Because it's not just about aspiring to reach such positions, it's being confident and comfortable creating positive change when you get there. Next slide. So research from the Harvard Business Review finds that while both men and women benefit from having a network of well-connected peers across different groups, women who also have an inner circle of female contacts are more likely to land executive positions with greater authority and higher pay. Interestingly, there was no effect found for men and for the composition of their inner circles. So how do we explain this? Well, women trying to climb up the leadership ladder, they face cultural and systemic hurdles that make it harder for them to advance, like unconscious gender bias. I believe the keynote last year might have been on that topic. So if you were here, you'll remember. And you'll also, I'm sure, remember that both women and men can engage in gender bias and related behaviors, even for or against women. Once again, connection with other women are key. Those you can go to and learn from about specifics to your career, dealing with pressures, and or work-life balance. Now that's important today. Women who have been there and done that need to pave the way. That is, change the culture and norms and expectations for women in business environments, but also change the policies and practices too. So what if it's a little lonely at the top? You don't have other women or other women at your level to go to. You may need to look beyond your company or organization to find them, and I'd encourage you to do so. Community or industry female networks, online groups, or even larger scale women's conferences when they can get back in session. There are a number of great groups out there with varying models, and so many have adapted well to remote platforms since the pandemic. We all need connections now more than ever. Next slide, please. So what do I like best about what's working for women in these all-female experiences? First, access to role models. If you can see it, you can be it. Safe and confidential groups and spaces where norms are created and owned together. Small defined groups also work well when they're across career level or type, or affinity groups based on race or parents and caregivers, or the intersection among these things. Real skill building, that is those soft skills that are critical to collaboration, negotiation, inclusion, and self-promotion. Integration of work and life. Now, I had actually had this on the slide when I was preparing even prior to the pandemic. Now, work and life is so blended, we can't even talk about the artificial dichotomy or the alternate personas that we used to go to work with. You know, I might be a professional staff member at a large corporation, and I somehow pretend I wasn't also going home to make dinner for my kids. Community-based to drive sustainable connection and see that roles are attainable for women like me or women from my community. And then finally, on-demand access through technology and apps. Today, I might want content. Tonight, I might want a real in-person connection or to run something by someone like me. Next slide, please. So now I'm going to talk about another study. And this study was by a different set of researchers. And it really demonstrates that all female experiences aren't just nice to haves, they have impressive long-term effects too. So prior to the pandemic, there was a series called Conferences for Women, and I sure hope they're still out there. They're just waiting to get back together. And there was a group of researchers who decided to study these conferences and look at the benefits long-term on women. Not surprisingly, they were focused on psychological benefits, and they saw some, but also the financial and career pathing benefits too. They compared these women who signed up for the conference to a control group, but to limit selection bias, that is that the control group or that the women signing up for such conferences might be unique or special in some way, they made all of the women who had signed up for these conferences participate in the study, and they compared those who had attended to those who had not. So not surprisingly, those who had attended had elevated feelings of optimism and connection 1 year following the conference. But there were remarkable financial benefits too. You can see them on the screen. So for the women who signed up but had not yet attended the conference, 18% received a promotion during the 1 year study period. But this compares to 42% of those who had attended the conference. So in other words, the year after connecting with peers at the Conference for Women, the likelihood of receiving a promotion doubled. There were other incredible findings, including pay increases too, but I won't share those today. So what was critical here? What were the drivers of these successful outcomes for women? Well, there were many of the things that I just talked about on the previous slide, seeing accessible role models, getting to share stories, having lived connections that you would maintain with other women. They were regional conferences, so they were within people's general region or own communities. So they could sustain those relationships perhaps more easily and in person. And they did small group skill building as well. Next slide. So now I've got some practical tips for getting the most out of your all-female experiences. The first is connect smartly. Do your best to connect with people who are facing similar challenges at work. Right now, that could be maybe managing large teams via Zoom, figuring out the next steps for when we go back to in-person work. Having some connections from a similar life stage or responsibility level at work can be helpful too. Reach out to them, even if you're still working remotely. In fact, the fact that we're all still working remotely, or so many of us are, that's a great entree into your perhaps connection via social media. And don't feel that you have to go overly formal with a social media introduction. Keep it short and simple, and then see if you can connect in person via video conference. Women need a bench of trusted advisors. If this still sounds hard, go to number two. Take the work out of networking. Just do it. Simply putting yourself in environments that give you the opportunity to meet female peers, even if those environments are not related to your career, because they could be like book clubs or online or in-person cooking classes, they can be helpful. Getting to know one another, sharing experiences, it's a game changer. It can forge lifelong, meaningful relationships, but also open up new career opportunities. And the more you do it, the more you keep putting yourself out there, the less pressure and stress you have about the formal networking. Speak directly with and about other women, even when they're not in the room or on the Microsoft Teams meeting. We tend not to do this. We give each other superficial compliments like, oh, you look amazing today. People are even doing this actually on Zoom. But we don't often share the praise or repeat back the praise from others to the person who should receive it on a job well done. And it feels so good to hear it, and it feels great to give it. We need to continue these practices. And I think I've said now more than ever so many times during this talk, but it is true. We all need this now. This forges connections. It makes us feel valuable in our work role, as well as gives us a renewed sense of purpose. Now, this leads me to the shine theory. It's a practice in mutual investment in each other. When women are committed to the practice of recognizing and amplifying the accomplishments of other women. This can be especially powerful when there are a few women around the leadership table. When someone offers an idea or an opinion, another woman repeats and supports out loud what is said by her female colleague. Suddenly, women on Zoom today are feeling like they have to be called on or raise their hand. Men aren't doing this. So engage in a little bit of this shine theory and support your female colleagues, online or off. And speaking directly means no gossip. I used to talk about this a lot when I was at Girl Scouts of the USA, talking to girls. We all know what gossip is and how bad it feels. If you have an issue with someone or a word you may have been misunderstood, go directly to that person to work it out and speak about it. Passive-aggressive behavior and competition perpetuate when we let challenges with others linger. Mentor, sponsor, and receive. Mentor and sponsor other women, regardless of where you are in your own career trajectory. Seek out new connections who can serve as mentors and sponsors for you. Learning should be lifelong. These women can serve as go-tos for you for advice, for a pick-me-up, when you need a boost, or even door openers to new people and new opportunities, especially if you're interested in making a change. Finally, invest in all female spaces. CEOs, heads of organizations and offices, this one's especially for you. Invest in groups, networks, and conferences that build up all members of your organization or team, regardless of where people sit in the hierarchy. Managers, encourage your team members to seek out and attend such events and join such networks. And of course, fuel the pipeline. Invest in girls' clubs and groups in your community with your time as a volunteer or mentor or with your money so that these important experiences for girls will last well beyond this challenging time. Next slide. So at Girl Scouts, we talk a lot about preparing girls for the world. But a lot of my role when I was at Girl Scouts of the USA was engaging others to help them better understand what girls need and what they expect from the world. And I can tell you, girls have high expectations. As this is an event called Voice for Girls, I felt it important to share this talk with girls, and I had the great opportunity of attending the Girl Scouts of Orange County Lounge earlier this week with middle school and high school girls. I wanted to ask them what resonated about this talk with them, and we were very interactive. We had a great, nearly two-hour discussion. So much of this resonated with them, even if they're not yet in business environments. They've seen the women around them go through such similar issues or have heard about them. They face similar challenges in school and shared as such too. They have great concerns about diversity, equity, and inclusion for girls and women, but for all people. I wanted to share also that I asked them directly when I told them I'd be speaking to all of you on Friday today. I said, what do you want the audience to hear from you? If you had the platform, what would you tell them? And I've pulled four particular quotes. I'm going to read them specifically. That we are just as flawed and struggle just as much as the rest of you. And we should be given the same forgiveness and kindness you would give to someone else. Just because we are young blood doesn't mean we deserve to be treated worse or have more pressure placed upon us. From another girl. I honestly just want to be able to be trusted and people to believe in my power as a woman, while also seeing every facet of my identity and personality. I've got two more. I think that older generations sometimes find it hard to change traditional ways of thinking, since maybe they've been used to doing it that way for so long. But I think having our voice in the decisions that make up our lives is helpful. Work with us to decide what will happen in our future. It is our destiny. Believe that we will make the right choices in it. And then finally, I hope that in the future workplaces, I am supported and encouraged. In my life, partaking in Girl Scouts has allowed me to see the powerful female leaders and the possibilities for my future, and has shaped who I want to become. My Girl Scout Gold Award allowed me to heal my community as well as myself. I was able to overcome the grief I was experiencing from the pandemic, and it made me believe I could change anything. Now, those are pretty powerful comments. Totally inspiring, too. So I thank you so much for having me here today. I think we have a few more minutes for some questions, comments from our attendees. Oh, we have our first one right now. Do you have national all-female networks you recommend women check out, even if they aren't in our own community? Thanks for the latter part of that, because I did suggest that those that are in your own community are incredibly beneficial. I have a few different ones to mention at the national level, and most of them have adapted well to the online opportunities. Chief is a new national network, relatively new, like a couple of years old. Therefore, exceptionally high level women, often women in tech and in corporate environments. The National Black Business Network National Black Women's Business Network is also one that comes highly recommended. Evolve Me is a new network for women who are 50 or older and are looking to change careers in midlife. And Lean In Circles, and those are pretty well known, but they're wonderful, smaller, and community-based and around the country. Other questions? Oh, here's a good one. So do all male spaces matter in similar ways for men or for boys? Generally, they don't matter in the same significant ways. I'm not arguing against men having close relationships with other men or all male experiences. But what tends to happen is both men and women manifest gender-based stereotypes in mixed environments. And so when they are mixed for men and women, men tend to, the research suggests, and I'm talking in generalizations here, dominate. And women tend to manifest stereotypes where they become a bit more willing to be submissive and raise hands on Zoom and things like that, ask permission, engage in upspeaking, for example, in meetings. So no, the research does not bear out that all male spaces benefit men or boys, frankly, in the same ways. Other questions? Comments? The value of girl-only spaces is clear for girls' healthy development. How do we help young boys view girls as capable and confident so they will grow up to champion women and girls? Well, I talked about how boys and girls get a little bit more stereotypical, especially at the younger ages, when they're in mixed groups. But mixed groups are still incredibly important for them to see those girls and women are capable. And I think particularly like mixing them on project teams and things like that within classrooms or community activities is a great opportunity. And mixed group friendships. I'm seeing more of those actually, even in my own community. I'm coming to you from New York, where it used to be that at the youngest ages, boys and girls would be friends, but then they would kind of go off and there would be more all-female relationships or all-male relationships. I'm seeing more blending, which I think is great. My own son, one of his very best friends throughout elementary, middle, and high school, is actually a girl. So there's a personal example of that. Other questions? There are no other questions. So I thank you so much for having me here today. I will take that as a great sign. I hope you all took a little nugget or left inspired by those great quotes from the girls who were in the lounge last week. I was delighted to join you here today, and I'm going to send you off to what I know will be more inspiration, an amazing panel. Thank you for joining me at Voice for Girls 2021.
Thank you, Dr. A. We so appreciate your many insights into this important topic. We know that women's leadership brings many important economic and societal benefits, and we're doing everything we can at Girl Scouts to fuel the pipeline for tomorrow's change makers, cure finders, and beacons of inspiration. Speaking of strong female leaders, it is now my pleasure to introduce our remarkably talented panelists and Girl Scout moderators for today's panel discussion. Anne Bertana, Principal and Co-Managing Director, Gensler. Patty Harvey, Senior Vice President, Quality, Regulatory, and Clinical Operations Support, Kaiser Permanente. Mara Pagotto, Vice President, Enterprise, People Strategy, Development and Culture, Western Digital. And Reshma Peck, Senior Vice President, Marketing, Experian North America. Thank you all for sharing your time and perspectives with us. And I'm delighted to introduce our two accomplished Girl Scouts who will be moderating the conversation. Marisol Cazares is Girl Scout Ambassador in her senior year at Rosary Academy. And Kirsten Okamoto, a Girl Scout Ambassador in her senior year at Sado Academy High School. Ladies, thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Shep. Hi, I'm Marisol, and welcome to our panel discussion. We are truly honored to have four very accomplished Orange County leaders joining us today. They will be sharing their insights and experiences with female affinity groups.
Thank you, Marisol. Hi, I'm Kirsten, and indeed, we are particularly excited to learn more about how female affinity groups, an integral part of creating an inclusive work environment, are helping to drive the recruitment, retention, and performance of women in the workplace.
That's right, Kirsten. Let's dive into this important discussion. Ms. Pretenia, we'll start with you. How is your company creating safe spaces for women? In other words, does Gensler support women in their most authentic selves in the workplace? Do they help themselves feel comfortable speaking up and asking for what they need?
That's a great question, Marisol. So architecture has historically been a male, white dominated field, and Gensler's really been focused on changing that demographic. So it started more than 15 years ago. We have a male and female partnership as our co-CEOs, and this diverse leadership structure has really spread throughout the firm. So really modeling this diversity is the first step in creating a place where women can see themselves as future leaders in our firm. We also have what we call a people first philosophy, because we believe it truly begins and ends with our people, and we encourage them to pursue their passions. So we really invest in creating opportunities for growth for them to meet their professional goals. We have a variety of coaching, mentorship, and leadership programs that can help women of all ages and stages of their career support one another. So this can be in regular one-on-one meetings with their coach or mentor, or in small groups of, you know, 4 to 6 women getting together over breakfast or maybe a happy hour to share their own experiences, including, you know, their struggles, their successes. And sharing all of that really helps one another maneuver and advance their own personal success. I think the key is really the openness and the relationships formed in these sorts of settings help women learn the skills they need, and most importantly, give everyone the confidence to speak up for themselves. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Now, to Ms. Harvey. Thank you for the tremendous commitment and support that first responders at Kaiser and other health organizations across Orange County have been providing our communities during this challenging time. We are so very grateful. What suggestions do you have for companies that want to start a female affinity group within their organization?
Oh, thank you, Kirsten, so much for the opportunity to talk to you today. It's so such a great honor. Also, thank you, Dr. A. You got my blood going, so I'm excited to share this with us today. So first of all, an affinity group. And let's get really clear on perhaps what the definition is. Because, for example, at Kaiser Permanente, we don't call them affinity groups. We call them business resource groups. So grounding, it's really a group or an opportunity for staff or teams to engage. That group increases the inclusion, and it also helps align around values and culture. And that is one of the sole purposes that, from a Kaiser Permanente perspective, that we founded affinity or business resource groups. Mm-hmm. I am very blessed in our organization, especially in Southern California, is that I am the senior sponsor for We at KP. And We at KP stands for Women Empowered at KP. And so there are actually some tips, like 10 easy steps. If you want to start an affinity group or a business resource group or a women empowered at your organization group. And so I'll just quickly go through what those steps are. One of the most enlightening groups that I've been able to join, though, before I get into the steps, is something called Chicks in Charge. So I thought this was such a cool affinity group for women leaders, and it's specifically in healthcare. And, you know, we were middle-aged women trying to figure out, so how are we going to navigate this path? And so Chicks in Charge just sounded like, you know, that sounds like us. So we'll just go for it. So when we started to talk about what Chicks in Charge were, the first thing we had to figure out was why we wanted to do this. What was our goal? And then we had to figure out who our people were, who our allies were, who our constituents were, who were our common alliances. And then we had to make our case. You know, why does this matter? Who does it matter to? What effort is important? Then we had to share it with a group of leaders. For example, at KP, we needed to have sponsorship from our organization. Our most senior leaders in Kaiser Permanente had to believe in this cause. And then we had to share it with our employees, our staff, our leadership groups, so that they would understand the opportunity and the real benefit of coming together with folks who are like you. And then we had to strategically tie it to things that were important to our organization, whether it was Chicks in Charge and helping with professional development and joint problem solving about business issues or professional issues. Are we at KP, where we tied it to inclusion, diversity, and making sure we addressed inequities in our organization? But then you also have to make sure you've got the resources dedicated to support it. And this is one of those areas that you just get started. You just do it. You know, it's never going to be perfect, so you get it good enough to get going. And I know that Reshma is going to talk just a little bit about what those success measures are. And that is so important, because you just got to get started and you have to kind of have a clear image in your mind what success looks like in an affinity group. And then you have to figure out, how do you want to come together? Do you want to come together virtually like we are this morning? Do you want to try to organize a hike or an outdoor activity where you can fellowship outdoors? What are you going to talk about, and who's responsible for that? So those agendas and roles of responsibility are right there. And there's got to be rules. Oh my goodness, you don't want to get in trouble with your organization. So you got to make sure that you understand what you can and you can't do within your organization. So that's really important. And then think holistically. This is, you know, there's nothing to prevent us from saving the world. And so be thinking about how this can actually help the folks within your affinity group or your business resource group, and how can it also help the greater organization and the greater community? And then communicate. Golly jeepers, you need to talk about this a lot. The outcomes of the group, the members of the group, the purpose of the group, and then probably the most important thing about starting an affinity group or a business resource group, you got to be patient. You got to give folks a chance to understand where they fit, and then have the courage and to keep going in. So I hope that answers.
Thank you, Ms. Peck.
You know what? I'll just add. And Patty, I'll just add one more thing. You know, I think Patty hit on it, is governance. It's really important to have, you know, committees and sponsors. It's a side of desk job. It's a side hustle, you know, for a lot of us. So, you know, to making sure that we're getting people to commit. And in our company, we say, hey, give 1 to 2 years and then we'll rotate, you know, that sponsorship or that committee leadership. And then also recognize those people that are accomplishing these things, not just for their jobs, but for this, you know, movement that they're creating in the company. So giving them exposure and opportunities, you know, and it's performance related metrics. So, you know, it is a side hustle. And so we need to recognize that.
Thank you. Ms. Peck, what is the primary goal of experienced female affinity groups? Is it to drive change, solve particular issues, or is it something else?
It's all of those things. Thank you, Kirsten and Marisol, for having me in that question. I'm thrilled to be here, and I really appreciate being here with all these wonderful ladies. Let me step back a little bit and provide context. So our mission at Experian is to power opportunities to create a better tomorrow. So not just for the consumers and the companies, but for also for employees, for everyone. And we believe we're stronger when we create those meaningful opportunities that support and promote diversity and inclusion throughout our organization. And you know, the keynote speaker touched on this, but it's no longer a debate. Companies with female executives perform better. Several studies have looked at financial returns, share evaluation, employee engagement, and they perform better. So not only is it the right thing to do, but maybe it's a capitalist view, but it pays off, you know? So, and that led to us ensuring that we have a more purposeful framework to achieve our goals of gender diversity at every level. So our focus originally started at ensuring there was female representation at the senior executive level. So 5 years ago, we set out of a goal of 40% executive leadership positions, positions like chief officers, presidents, executive vice presidents. And we're proud to say we've achieved that. We also have 4 women on our global board of directors. And, you know, when you have 3, that's the tipping point. That's when the dialogue shifts in the room. So you got to get past that 3. And the program that drives this dominant goal is, you know, similar to Patty's, as well as the goals around people engagement, is our female affinity group, which we call Employee Resource Group, is called Women in Experian. Very similar, Patty. It's called, it's W-I-E, so it's we. And so it's part of a holistic diversity, equity, and inclusion focus for our company. Because, you know, one thing to remember, it's about all diversity and inclusion. So we have 8 employee resource groups and multiple clubs that are representing our entire employee base. The WE program is rooted in mentorship, networking, education, and leadership. And we have activities and programs that focus on all those areas, like our Experian Business Network that connects people across North America and the globe. And we talked about networking and how important that is. A robust mentoring program that was talked about it. And we assign senior executives to high performers to be sponsors and to be mentors, community involvement to power this next generation of you. And certainly education and support, not only for careers, but also for managing personal situations. I mean, you know, the reality is, I'll emphasize, is the support for women in personal lives is equally as important to help with their professional lives. This struggle of the juggle is real. Priorities blend and mount, and everyone's talked about it. And this past year illuminated that more than ever. And I'm speaking firsthand. I'll give you an example that many of us can appreciate. So to help parents and caregivers, we forged a partnership with a service that provides caregivers and babysitters. And that benefit really helped this working mom. I mean, trying to find a quiet, clean corner for my video calls, you know, being thrown into becoming a homeschool teacher, 4th grade math, 7th grade math, I just don't understand it. You know, and to cook so many meals a day, I don't know about you, but my kids ate a lot, and a Wi-Fi technician, and, you know, so on and so on. And to be able to get access to this resource was tremendous. So, you know, as we progressed in our journey over the last 5 years, our goal now is 50% female representation across the company. And why not? The U.S. working population is 50%. So why can't we strive for the same? And so now our journey continues to increase that pace of progress, spend more time on foundational levels, get to 50% in pre-manager and pre-senior levels, and overall just continue to promote understanding of the unique needs of a diverse population.
Thank you so much.
Beautiful.
So trying to keep this brief as I'm looking at the clock, Ms. Peck, how does Experion measure the success of its female affinity programs? And what is the most successful outcome or metric you've seen?
Sure. Well, we're a data company, so we track and measure everything you can think of. We have these talent-related metrics. I'll make it quick. It's first, how many females versus males do we have in each business area, function, and by level? We look at promotion rates at every level. Are females being promoted at the same rate as males? Pay rate equity by level. And recruiting. Are we getting a diverse pool of candidates for each position? Is a pipeline coming in? And in those functions where it may be harder, like tech and data scientists, we proactively invest in recruiting from specific colleges or events like, you know, going to Grace Hopper. And then each business leader or functional leader has a scorecard, and that rolls into the global scorecard for the board to keep everybody accountable. And then we have people engagement metrics. You know, we've got to get a feel of how important is this work we're doing. So everything around how many members we have, mentors, mentees, feedback, mm-hmm. internal feedback, external feedback, engagement in our events. And you know, one last thing I'll say is also making sure we have male allies. It is critical to have a balanced view of leadership and advocacy and understanding from our male colleagues. We just can't speak to ourselves. We really need our entire community so we all rise together. Some of these metrics are weighted heavier than others, but they all play a part in, you know, getting us to the ultimate goal.
Thank you, Ms. Peck.
Pleasure.
Finally, Ms. Pagotto, from your experience at Western Digital, what do you think is the most important reason companies should hire more women?
Thank you. I'm so excited to answer this question because I feel I can really speak to it from experience. First part of my career was in a male-dominated industry and on a male-dominated leadership team. And while I was fortunate to have had strong mentors around me, something was missing for me and I couldn't put my finger on it. So it wasn't until about 10 years ago that I got to experience what a team of qualified men and women could really achieve. So in my humble opinion, women bring a critical dimension to leadership and the workforce that just simply elevates the employee experience. Women have a unique ability to inspire and motivate. We're strong, we're resilient, we're agile, yet we're empathetic and we're curious and creative. These capabilities are more important than ever in the workplace today. They strengthen employee engagement and they truly differentiate successful companies and great places to work. We see how these capabilities show up with companies where more women serve on their boards of directors. These boards recognize a correlation between strong employee engagement, great culture, and business success, and they keep this at the forefront. So it's not to say that men are absent these capabilities, but the contribution that women make to leadership in the workforce really help amplify it. That's why I think companies should hire more women.
And Ms. Harvey, I know this question also speaks to you. Is there anything you would like to add?
Mara, you said that so beautifully. I mean, I got sweaty palms just listening to it. So thank you. I think you spoke for all of us. For the three words that we actually started the discussion today, courage, confidence, and character. You know, as organizations want to invest in courageous authenticity, if they want folks who represent the clientele in Kaiser Permanente's perspective, the patients in which we serve, the decision makers in the household, the customers which buy their products, that's women. Confidence. Who else? And Reshma told such a great story about not only having to be a senior vice president, but she also had to be a math teacher, a chief cook, and bottle washer. So you got to have confidence to be able to do that. That's what women bring to the workforce. An innate confidence that says, you know, no matter what happens, we can suck it up and get it done because that's what we do. And then character. We are by nature, by values, by roles, by our DNA and genetic makeup, a sense of nurturers, people who try to ensure that we see a greater good, than just what's facing us in front of us. And so those three reasons, if no other ones, courage, confidence, and character are why each one of us should invest the time in hiring and associating and promoting women in leadership. Hope that resonates with the rest of y'all.
With that, we are unfortunately out of time.
Yes, this insightful conversation could go on for quite a while.
Thank you all for speaking with us today and sharing your insights on how companies can embrace women and everything they bring to today's workforce.
It is now our pleasure to introduce you to our two sisters who are Gold Award Girl Scouts, who will share with you how they are using their Girl Scout leadership experience to make the world a better place.
My name is Jacqueline Lambesis. I'm a freshman at Cal State Fullerton, and I'm a Gold Award Girl Scout. I started Girl Scouts when I was a Daisy and graduated as an ambassador. That's 13 years of sisterhood. My Girl Scout Gold Award project was related to mental health outreach at my high school. It was motivated by my own childhood experiences at CHOC, Children's Hospital of Orange County. Along with partners from CHOC's new mental health clinic, I created posters for coping strategies for anxiety and depression and put them up around my high school. The posters also let kids know who they could turn to if they or people they know were dealing with anxiety or signs of depression. I also created brochures and cards for my school's mental health support club, which they gave out to the student body during Mental Health Week. Finally, I helped form a wellness team on my campus, complete with teachers, staff, and rotating student body representatives who could both serve the students and teach the staff how they could best help the students. This included looking out for signs of anxiety and depression and knowing what their role is as educators. I'm proud of the impact my project had on my school community. And I'm grateful to see that the school is continuing to provide support for the student body after I graduated last year. That's the power of the Girl Scout Gold Award, sustainable solutions. My Gold Award project was challenging, and there were numerous bumps in the road in getting my project ready. To keep the momentum going, I ultimately solicited support from the superintendent of the school district, who recognized the incredible value and importance of mental health support in our schools. In the end, learning to push through, lead, and work with a team were extraordinary lessons I will take with me into the future. I now have the confidence to overcome whatever challenges come my way.
My name is Anne Vong, and I am a Gold Award Girl Scout. I joined Girl Scouts a little later than most, in seventh grade, when my parents were hoping that it would help me gain the confidence that I needed to overcome a stuttering problem. Ultimately, my Girl Scout experience not only helped me find confidence, but it also helped me find my own voice, one that came from being part of a large and supportive scouting family. You may have noticed that my uniform is a little different, and that is because I come from a Vietnamese-American scouting troop that incorporates Vietnamese scouting traditions along with Girl Scouting. My troop, Linh Duong Chi Lang, was founded in 1979 by Vietnamese refugees who were hoping to find their own home in the United States. Today, the troop includes immigrants and second-generation Vietnamese Americans like myself. Growing up in the troop helped me develop a deep love for culture, which inspired my Girl Scout Gold Award project. I collaborated with cultural nonprofit organizations and student clubs across Southern California to bring cultural arts festivals to community centers, libraries, and elementary schools. Though I'll be graduating soon and pursuing my studies in public health towards medicine, I will continue serving Girl Scouts as a Silver and Gold Award Youth Advisor in order to help girls pursue their own passions and transform it into projects that can impact their community and beyond.
Wow, what extraordinarily inspiring stories of Girl Scouts. I'm Jody Duva, Vice President of Cox Business here in Orange County and Girl Scouts of Orange County board member. I'm passionate about seeing girls and women succeed in all parts of their lives, both personally and professionally. That's one of the reasons I love my job and volunteering my time to advance the quality of life for residents and businesses in our community. At Cox, we champion inclusion, embrace our diverse communities, and empower great people to build a better future together. Cox Business is honored this morning to introduce our Voice for Girls Spotlight honorees. These impressive individuals are recognized by their organizations for advancing the quality of work and life for women. As you view our spotlights, we hope that you share our excitement in the remarkable work that they're doing and thank them for championing female ambition and leadership. In appreciation of their achievements, a beautiful orchid planter from Rogers Gardens, complete with a hand-painted kindness rock from a local Girl Scouts troop, was delivered to each honoree.
Girl Scouts of Orange County is proud to recognize the following Advancing Women in Leadership Spotlight recipients. Wendy Aid, presented by Cox Business. Kathy Bonney, presented by Clearinghouse, CDFI. Selena Campbell, presented by Cox Business. Stacy Diebel Reynolds, presented by the Orange County Department of Education. Selena Doka, presented by KPMG. Shannon Yusey, presented by Beacon Point. Ruby Gills, presented by Kaiser Permanente. Emily Grant, presented by SoCal Gas. Dr. Darla Holland, presented by Kaiser Permanente. Mandy Morgan, presented by Dale Carnegie. Anya Ostry, presented by CBRE. Vanessa Page, presented by Union Bank. Erin Pheasant, presented by U.S. Bank. Dr. Chiarina Piazza, presented by West Coast University. Nicole Provençal, presented by Angels Baseball. Alyssa Schultz, presented by Gensler. Kami Stevens, presented by Beacon Point. Jennifer Tellers, presented by Union Bank. On behalf of Girl Scouts across Orange County, congratulations again to all of the Advancing Women in Leadership Spotlight recipients.
Thank you, Girl Scouts of Orange County, for recognizing these trailblazers who are paving the way for our next generation of female leaders. I'd now like to introduce Gina Osborne, Executive Leadership Coach, International Keynote and Podcast Host, former FBI Special Agent and Army Veteran, and also fellow Girl Scouts Board Member, along with Danny Remington Smithson, Executive Vice President and Regional Manager of Bank of Southern California. These amazing and accomplished women are co-chairing the Girl Scouts of Orange County's inaugural Challenge Cup, and I know that you will share my excitement as you hear more. Take it away, ladies.
Thanks, Jody. Danny and I are excited to kick off Girl Scouts of Orange County's first ever Challenge Cup, which will be held Sunday, September 26th at Newport Dunes. Think about an exciting afternoon filled with Girl Scout-inspired competitions led by Girl Scouts that challenge participants' skills in outdoor adventure, STEM, entrepreneurship, and life skills, the four program pillars of Girl Scouts. Sounds like a lot of fun, right? We're looking for 12 teams to compete in this friendly challenge. Is that you?
Thanks, Gina. And that's not all. We'll end the day with a special award ceremony and luau dinner honoring our winners and celebrating all challengers. To learn more, click on the link in our chat. When you participate in Girl Scouts of Orange County's Challenge Cup, not only are you signing up for a fun-filled team bonding experience, you invest in girls who will change the world. We'll see you there, and mahalo. Now, to close out this morning's program and remind us of the infinite possibilities for today's girls, we'd like to bring Girl Scout Ambassador Sabine back to share how Girl Scouts has prepared her for a lifetime of leadership.
Joining Girl Scouts at just 5 years old, it really feels like Girl Scouts has been part of my entire life. Reflecting on my journey, I can see clearly that each step along the way has prepared me for a lifetime of leadership and empowered me to be an agent of change in my community and beyond. During my 13 years in Girl Scouts, from daisies to ambassadors, Girl Scouts grew my perspective on my community and the world. I've traveled from San Francisco to Savannah, Georgia, the birthplace of the Girl Scout movement. I witnessed a presidential inauguration in Washington, D.C., and helped rescue marine life in Central America. These were life-changing opportunities that took me beyond the textbook. When it came time to design my Girl Scout Gold Award project, it felt natural to give others the opportunity to learn outside of the classroom too. I started clubs at elementary schools in my community that invited kids to participate in hands-on scientific experiments and hopefully spark their passion for science. Recently, I joined a delegation of Girl Scouts from across the nation, speaking at the United Nations Commission on the Status of Women about gender equality. My participation gives me a voice in changing the inequality that girls and young women worldwide experience, inequality which leads them to be disproportionately burdened by many issues affecting humankind. Through Girl Scouts, I found my voice, and I know I will continue to give a voice to others around the globe. Girls have the power to change the world. I believe in this wholeheartedly. When you support Girl Scouts as a volunteer or a donor, you champion girls' ambition and help Girl Scouts of Orange County provide all girls, regardless of age, background, or ability, the life-changing benefits that Girl Scouts provides them to dream big and do bigger. The 2.5 million Girl Scouts across the country are honing their leadership skills and will soon bring their confidence, experience, and problem-solving skills into the workforce. And we're really excited. We hope you're inspired to support Girl Scouts in building girls of courage, confidence, and character, like me and my sister Girl Scouts, who are primed and ready to make the world a better place. Girl Scouts, working together with all of you, are changemakers for today, tomorrow, and forever. Thank you for joining us at Voice for Girls 2021.